in this episode of Art Loft, a mosaic of the Keys.
We started the Mosaic Project 5 years ago as a community awareness project. We distribute almost 400 canvases each year, 80% artists and 20% community members.
Carol Harris, quilting stories beneath the surface.
My mother taught me embroidery, and I can remember going to the 5 and 10 cent store to buy those embroidery floss, but it looked like a color wheel to me. That's my memory of it.
Cartoonist Mike Peters infuses real life into his work.
And in art school, he did what he did best, which was draw cartoons for, you know, the newspaper and the yearbook and stuff, instead of going to class, because nobody ever told him going to class is a good idea.
And Ralph Fasanella at the American Folk Art Museum.
Ralph Fasanella was born in the Bronx in 1914. His parents were Italian immigrants. His works are reflecting social reality and are carrying messages of hope.
It's all ahead in this episode of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by Friends of Art and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Lolo Reskin. And from the studios here at South Florida PBS, this is Art Loft. Welcome back. I'm Lolo Reskin. We're exploring fascinating stories in quilting, cartoons, and more this week on Art Loft. First up, we head to Key Largo to check out a one-of-a-kind epic artwork. For the 5th Annual Connections Project, the Florida Keys Council of the Arts provided 6-inch by 6-inch blank canvases to 400 artists and community members. Join us as we chat with some of the artists behind this Mosaic of the Keys.
We started the Mosaic Project 5 years ago as a community awareness project. We distribute almost 400 canvases each year, 80% artists and 20% community members. We creatively connect by doing a canvas, and some of them are painted, some of them are quilt, that reflect the beauty of the Florida Keys. So we don't have a theme, except for that they're going to be connected. My piece is of a Key West sunset. I was walking home and I took a photograph of this really beautiful pinky purpley sky. And then I went to one of the Key West free workshops and I had some real artists help me.
We start with the first reception in Key Largo and work our way down Isla Mirada, Marathon, Big Pine, and then Key West. And people get to see other artists' work from up and down the Keys and really integrates us and makes us learn about our fellow artists that might live 100 miles away. And it really is exciting. It's kind of like a treasure hunt. There isn't a map to it. You have to look at all the canvases in order to find your own. I do encaustic painting, which is painting with wax on wood surfaces. So I took the canvas off, put a wood panel on, and I did a hibiscus this year in honor of Chris Sandifer, our beloved originator of this project.
For my art, I mean, it's, you know, this is why we live here. It's the Keys. It's our little piece of paradise. It's 3 palm trees, water, clouds, and reflection on the water. I'm just nothing but proud. This, I think, is the only project that we all collaborate or connect on. There are always the Keys shots, but what I'm seeing more and more of are the fun things. Things that are pasted on the canvas, the beads, the little leg of a doll sticking out, the watches, just the humorous things.
Each piece is unique and has the flair of that artist, what's in their mind. It's a catalyst for conversation for the viewer and for the artist.
My piece represents the area around us. One of the pieces I did were frangipanis in a glass and a vase bowl. The other was a stone crab claw because I think they're really indicative of what people come to the Keys.
This year I chose a local scene, which is the Lorelei, and that is in Isla Mirada. One of the areas that I really like is where the little dinghies come in, and I happened to capture a scene that has the birds sitting there on each post. I am a plein air artist, and this year, each plein air artist was given a canvas and asked to paint. So what's so exciting to me is that amongst the canvases that you might have someone who's never painted before, and you might have someone that little canvas is probably worth a lot of money, and that you can get a piece of art that will touch your heart forever.
This program here is chaired with producing more money for the grants in the schools, and that's what we try to raise money for that purpose. I did a loggerhead turtle. In this community, we have a turtle hospital, which gives a lot of the turtles rescue. It's a great, great image. And if you've ever been diving, and if you see a turtle in the water, they are just so amazing. Good quality artists, really, really good quality. So it's exciting.
The impact of a 24-foot long, 4-foot high piece of art that's made up of almost 400 different people's artwork is just inspiring.
Coming up on Art Loft.
Don't draw a figure, exaggerate it. Exaggerate the figure, make it into a cartoon. When you go to painting class, paint a cartoon. When you go to design class, design a cartoon. I said, Mr. Brunel, won't they get mad? He said, Mike, you're already flunking, it's okay.
Everyone has a story as unique as themselves. In this profile from Detroit Public TV, we meet an artist who reveals her story through the fiber arts. Layer by layer, she authors tales of Detroit's architectural history and her personal past, while making room for the viewer to find their own meaning. Take a look.
I love beautiful fabrics. I love the feel of them, the smell of them even. All my quilts, I feel, are my children, and I have no favorites. Each one, when I'm doing it at that time, is my favorite. I grew up in Detroit. I've been here all my life. First fiber work I can remember was embroidery. My mother taught me embroidery, and I can remember going to the 5 and 10 cent store to buy those embroidery floss. But it looked like a color wheel to me. That's my memory of it, all these colors just lined up one next to another. So I think that's kind of where it all started. And right now, I'm working with hand stitching and embroidery a lot, so I'm going back to the very first kind of stitchery that I ever learned. You have 3 layers. That's what makes a quilt: a bottom, a middle batting, and a top. And you stitch those 3 together, you've got a quilt. Now, what you do with it after that is where the real creativity comes in.
I like to work with color. I like a lot of color. But every now and again, I will challenge myself to do something with no color, black and white.
I get a lot of joy out of the making, how I put these pieces together.
Now, it's all very random, but they should work nicely together. I don't want to place one that's got, because I'm trying to create energy and rhythms, I don't want to create one that's very much like it right next to it. So this doesn't have the same kind of dynamics or dynamism as, say, this one does. High contrast, very high contrast.
I love music, and I like the rhythms of music. I try to recreate high energy and the flow of music sometimes in my work. So I often am inspired by everything around me. The inspiration or the final product often does not necessarily reflect literally the inspiration, but it's just a starting point. And for me with fabric, it's always the fabric that is the beginning. And I'm never really at a loss for ideas because I have all this fabric around me and I can just go to it, pick one up, or it will call me and I will pick that one up and it will be the beginning of something. and that's how work starts.
So maybe we want it to go together in a sort of a chevron pattern.
The series that I'm working on right now is a great departure for the kinds of quilts that I made for maybe the last 30, 40 years. They've been sort of inspired again by looking at these houses and architecture. And I don't want to say ruined porn, but you see the marks that time has made on the landscape, whether it's natural landscape or man-made. And those marks are very beautiful, and they tell stories about the lives of those buildings and the people that have used those buildings. And I liked what the layers revealed. So I am now making holes in things so that you can see the layers, so the layers reveal something else. And then layering pieces one on top of the other in a way that you can see more than one fabric, each fabric being a part of a story. It's kind of like an onion, you know, you peel away, keep peeling, each one. Each layer is a little bit different than the one preceding it. I think of them as artifacts, and it tells a story of time and identity sometimes. I think that art is a collaboration between the maker and the viewer. And I make it, I may be thinking one thing and I see, but my experience is totally different from yours. And so what you bring to it is going to help you in interpreting this work and responding to it. Maybe it's telling your story. You know, maybe there's a layer that's a little bit fancier than what you see on top. I think the thing that I'm mostly saying is don't always be so concerned with what's on the surface, because that's not the whole story. That if you look beneath the surface, whether it's people, buildings, whatever, there's a lot more that's being revealed than what you see at first.
Coming up on Art Loft.
Subway Riders was made from sketches he made in the subway on his ride back from work. He said, "I'd ride the subway every day, back and forth, to my machine shop job. I'd ride and sketch and sketch."
The work of cartoonist Mike Peters is seen daily in over 800 newspapers worldwide. A lifetime of real-world experiences take shape each day in his editorials or in the canine antics of Mother Goose and Grimm. Take a look with Orlando's Central Florida PBS.
I still work for the Dayton Daily News in Dayton, Ohio, but it's like I live there because I have my computer. I get on their thing and I hear the newscast, what they think are the top stories, and I go, okay, I can do a cartoon about that, you know? And my editors, they're always amazed that I am so attuned about what's going on in Dayton, Ohio.
He worked for the Chicago Daily News and then the Dayton Daily News as an editorial cartoonist. And after he won the Pulitzer in 1981, he was being courted by bigger papers.
The syndicates had been asking me to do a comic strip, which is very rare. I mean, you know, usually you have to go and beg to do a comic strip to the syndicates. But I had been syndicated with my political cartoons.
We liked living Dayton, and we liked our kids growing up in Dayton, and he said he'd always wanted to do a comic strip and maybe that would be a good outlet.
But it never dawned on me that I was going to be doing it every day of my life for the next 30 years. I had no idea. So I'm going to art school, but in the meantime, I meet this girl, fabulous girl. You know, well, it turns out her father was the dean of students at Washington University.
And in art school, he did what he did best, which was draw cartoons for, you know, the newspaper and the yearbook and stuff, instead of going to class, because nobody ever told him going to class is a good idea, until he met this one professor who said, "You're a great cartoonist, do cartoons."
He said, "When you go to figure drawing class, don't draw a figure. Exaggerate the figure, make it into a cartoon. When you go to painting class, paint a cartoon. When you go to design class, design a cartoon." I said, "Mr. Brunel, won't they get mad?" He said, "Mike, you're already flunking. It's okay.
And then, much to my father's dismay, he started getting A's and B's and actually graduated.
It changed my life. I knew then that cartoons was my destiny, was my goal, was my bliss. I loved to do them. And obviously the world is telling me, you gotta do this. If you try to make up something, it's not as real as if you just do it right out of your life. And a lot of my stuff is right out of my life.
The comic strip came about pretty much out of his head, characters that he'd always played around with. And then the dog is him, he's the dog. And one time I proved it because the dog drinks out of toilets. Well, he doesn't do that, but he does eat out of trash cans. And I caught him. He was trying to wean himself off of Fritos.
So Marion came in one day to my office and she said, what are you doing? And I came up and I'm licking my finger and getting the crumbs of the Fritos down at the bottom. And she says, oh my God, you're the dog. I never realized I was the dog. I always thought the dog was just this entity that I was trying to do funny cartoons, but I was the dog. And once I learned that, the strip all came together. And I've been having a great time ever since. I'm in about 700 papers around the country, around the world. So it's great.
He is a very prolific creator. He comes up with thousands. I mean, all these pages here are filled with 50 or 100 ideas, which he won't use.
When I start a cartoon, I'm just writing ideas down, and then anything that hits my mind, I start developing it.
Any other cartoons would use the very first one and be done for the day. Whoa!
I still don't know if I'm going to do it, you know, and so it's over there.
Sometimes the standard's a little too high, and there's a deadline, and then there's standards. And I say, okay, go with the best of all these horrible ideas you came up with, any one of which most cartoons would kill for, you know.
And this was, my daughters are always saying to me, Dad, you've got a bat in the cave. And I was thinking, who could say that? So I have Lincoln saying to Roosevelt, Teddy, you've got a bat in your cave, which I thought was a funny idea because he probably does have a bat in his cave. But that's how I come up with ideas. I think of things, I write things down that my kids say or that people say on the news or that I see at a grocery store, and then I try to make it into something that's funny that people will hopefully laugh at. I know when I'm hitting my truth, it'll hit the truth of 1,000 other people out there. And then I always get good reaction from people because they say, oh my God, it's exactly true for me.
Next week on Art Loft.
I fell in love with Diane Arbus from an early age, so I knew about her work in undergrad. I like the way her work makes me feel when I look at it. So I redid the images from her Aperture monograph as self-portraits, and if there was any other character in the photograph, it was my family members. So it was sort of combining a combination of my work, which was family, and her work combined. And so I was the subject and I was the photographer.
For self-taught artist Ralph Fasanella, painting is more than an art form. It's a form of social advocacy. We go inside the American Folk Art Museum in New York City and take a look at Fasanella's large-scale canvases celebrating working-class neighborhoods. Member station WNET brings us this story.
Welcome to the American Folk Art Museum. My name is Valérie Rousseau. I'm curator for the 20th and 21st century self-taught art at the museum. Ralph Fasanella was born in the Bronx in 1914. His parents were Italian immigrants. His works are reflecting social reality and are carrying messages of hope, of liberty, and the respect for the rights of workers. Ralph Fasanella was a union organizer and started to paint mid-40s. Early on, Fasanelah helped his father to deliver ice, and the organization of his large-scale canvases with a lot of horizontal lines and stacking of subjects and architecture referred to his experience working with his father, where he was placing and replacing ice cubes in the refrigerators. Subway Riders was made from sketches he made in the subway on his ride back from work. He said, "I'd ride the subway every day, back and forth to my machine shop job. I'd ride and sketch and sketch. I love the subway. It pulls the city together, pulls people together in a magic way. Here I show the subway riders at night after a hard day's work. Everyone is separate, alone, but very much together. It's noisy with the creaks and squeals, but peaceful too, because we move to a rhythm that gets inside us. That's comforting. That's the noise of the city itself. The subway makes the city work, makes the city great." This painting is a large-scale painting, as many of the canvases by Ralph Fasanelah. Some of them are as wide as 10 feet. He said specifically that those paintings were meant to be seen by a lot of people at the same time. So it's one of the reasons why he wanted to have them large and also full of details. You can learn something about the personal life of each of those subjects. His painting were carrying two messages. I think the main message is that he was there to fight for the laborers' rights. And also, I think it's a celebration of New Yorkers.
Thanks for joining us this week on Art Loft. You can always connect with us on social media at ArtLoftSFL and watch us anytime on the PBS app by selecting WPBT2 as your local station. For Art Loft, I'm Lolo Reskin. See you next time.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by Friends of Art and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.